thanks for coming back to our second part of this series. Let me start reading. We are living in an age in which the behavioral sciences have become inescapable. The findings of social psychology and behavioral economics are being employed to determine the news we read, the products we buy, the cultural and intellectual spheres we inhabit, and the human networks, online and in real life, of which we are a part. Aspects of human societies that were formerly guided by habit and tradition, or spontaneity and whim, are now increasingly the intended or unintended consequences of decisions made on the basis of scientific theories of the human mind and human well-being. I'm reading from Tamsin Shaw's latest article in the New York Review of Books, entitled Invisible Manipulators of Your Mind, a review of The Undoing Project by Michael Lewis. And we had started the conversation yesterday with Tamsin and with Paul Dehaye and Michael Harris, and we're going to continue it today on these similar themes. Paul Dehaye and Jerome Groetenbriel are going to first be discussing the work they've been doing in the area of personal data protection and privacy, particularly in connection with their project, personaldata.io. And then, after the presentation, we'll all come up to the podium. Tamsin Shaw, professor of philosophy at NYU, the author of this most recent article and so many interesting interventions on these questions of personal information, privacy, and data, will intervene. And then Michael Harris, our own professor of mathematics, who I promised we would refer to. Our own professor of mathematics will then moderate the discussion that goes on. So, but without further ado.
Thank you. So again, it's a real pleasure to be here. And the conversation yesterday was fantastic. The reception was great. So I'm really happy to have a little talk here. The goal today is to enlarge the discussion to go beyond just Cambridge Analytica and to really deconstruct a little bit of what's happening at several different levels. And that's part of the conceptualization we're doing ahead of really starting offering services, so we're starting personal data and IO. And I think it could be helpful to discuss this conceptualization and related to actual examples, maybe later in the discussion. So before a little agenda, we'll present different perspectives, one from society, essentially civil society, then another market-based view, the geopolitics view, and finally offer some solutions. So Jerome will actually deal with this. But first, I want to present a viewpoint that I'll have here. And to try to convey this viewpoint to you, I want to start with an example that might be slightly more familiar here. So it's maybe unexpected, but I'll look at the situation with Native Americans and the law, US law. So I'm not a legal expert, but from my perspective, it's very interesting. Especially the way the law protects some goods that are not necessarily material. The US law tries to protect some goods that are not necessarily material and accommodate for a slightly different view that Native Americans themselves have on those goods. So the example is the Migratory Bird Treaty Act of 1918, where it's actually illegal to own an eagle feather, because this is a scarce resource and it's considered a valued resource in the US. So it's actually illegal to own, etc. There's all kinds of conditions. But if you're a Native American and you need those feathers to practice your religion, you're actually allowed to own this. So in some way, the law finds a way to accommodate this particular culture, if you want. There are all kinds of problems, of course. But then it becomes very interesting for these sweat lodges. So what are sweat lodges? They are sort of tents where Native Americans, as far as I understand, go to purify themselves. So they put stones in there, and they heat it up, and that's part of their purification process. But the very interesting aspect is that they see those stones as humans. as ancestors. They had a completely different view of the stones than the US modern would have, essentially, a non-Native American. And they're trying to protect this for different reasons, to fight cultural appropriation, etc. And they have a really hard time conveying across this difference in their perception of the whole ceremony and all the stones themselves. And of course, because of this difficulty, then it gets reappropriated by all kinds of new age movements, and they find that and so on. So, you can read about this in this paper, the difficulty of protecting Native spiritual identity. But my point of view here is that it's difficult to protect European digital identity for a lot of similar reasons. So let me expand a little bit on this European viewpoint. There's a very important concept in personal data protection. Of course, it's a definition of what personal data is. Any information related to an identified or identified to a natural person. So it's a very open view of what could be personal data. Very unlike the American view, where they define what personal identifiable information is, and it's a very restricted set. It's a very expensive, and the identifiable makes it forward-looking because it makes it depend on the technology. Right? If the technology improves, suddenly fingerprints can be used to identify someone. Well, fingerprints identify all information, it's personal data, essentially. Same thing with DNA, and for in the future, probably your gait analysis will determine who you are. Well, that's personal data. So, built on top of this personal data concept is the concept of information self-determination. This is the right for an individual to decide what information about himself should be communicated to others under what circumstances. And it goes a bit further, really means what that individual can do with your data. So basically, you should really be in control of your data. Why am I talking about this? Well, a very important thing to understand is that even the Charter of Fundamental Rights of the European Union, this is distinct from privacy protection. Right? So those are two separate particles. One is on the protection of personal data, Article 8, and one is on the respect for private life, Article 7. This has the same status as a constitution in the European Union. Although we'll see the subtle differences when England leaves and then Britain refuses to incorporate the Charter into its own region. But in any case, this distinction is important because if you're focused on data protection and you just think about privacy, you have a too narrow view. It's already interesting, as this famous article describes, there's already a different approach on privacy between the US and Europe. The one is focused on dignity and protecting the way you present yourself through data, and the other one is focused on liberty. Among other things, allows a platform to say almost anything they want about you under the cover of free speech. But that's very reductive to just think about the privacy angle. So let me give you a concrete example. How many of you know about the Facebook manipulation experiment? A few. Okay, so in 2012, Facebook engaged in active emotional manipulation of some of its users. So it took 700,000 users, or maybe more, and tried to make some of them happy and some of them sad. Just with the goal of discovering if they could or not. They partnered with Cornell, which was in itself a minefield for ethical concerns. But nevertheless, they did it and showed that this could have an effect, a statistically significant effect. Of course, at their scale, they are able to find much more tiny effects because the statistics. But nevertheless, they were able to find whether they could make people happy or sad. I can go into the detail of how they did it. But that's not a privacy invasion, really. I mean, they just figured it out for themselves, and then that's it. They didn't tell anyone. They had to be hard pressed, actually, to argue that this is a privacy invasion. I would argue that it's an affront to my own dignity if I'm a Facebook user, and they tried to do that. Right? So the European viewpoint is slightly different. Actually, when this happened, so they published this research in 2014, and then last year, it sort of really harassed them to try to figure out whether I was part of that experiment or not. So I was really intentionally using my rights to the maximum to find just one bit of information, yes or no. That's it. But I found that as the most prototypical example of this real difference and this obligation that Facebook would have, in my mind, to disclose what they were doing with their emotional manipulations. But of course, it's just one of hundreds, thousands of experiments they conduct every day. So in the end, I managed to get a response, and I was not part of that experiment. It took a really long time, but I did. And then I started helping my friends to figure it out. So I did request on their behalf. And eventually Facebook replied that they had deleted all the data. And so now we can no longer find out whether they were part of that experiment. Now that's just one example where it really goes to the core, the dignity of the individual. But there's a lot of interference with other rights as well, other fundamental rights. So before getting into that, I want to remind people maybe of Shoshana Zuboff's laws of information technology. It has three parts. First two quite simple: everything that can be automated will be automated. Everything that can be informated will be informated, in the sense that you can collect more and more data about the process. Once you're in that stage, every digital application that can be used for surveillance and control will be used for surveillance and control. That was quite insightful when the agents mentioned talked about that. But I want to encourage you now, with the examples I'll talk about, to think about surveillance and control. We're becoming more and more aware of this, but really think each time, okay, where is the surveillance and who is in control? How is that control deserved? So the first example that's really not that surprising that we included is speech. What's the impact of data protection on speech? How can fundamental right to data protection in European law have an impact on speech? But it can have an impact on two sides, on active speech and passive speech. Active speech is the classic one. If someone wants to say something, passive speech is my invention, or it's not mine, it's a friend's invention. Maybe we're co-authors on this, where someone has the right to listen to someone else. So it's already very interesting there, because usually that's assumed implicit when you combine right of assembly and right to free speech. Right? Because you're allowed to be near someone who's speaking, you're allowed to hear what they're saying. But online it's different. So on the left, an example of active speech where a platform sort of abuses their power or hasn't really conceptualized it enough to prevent abuses. So here, Marietjes Schaake is a parliamentarian from the Netherlands at the EU Parliament. She was talking about torture in an Asian country in the European Parliament. And she posted a video of this on YouTube. And the video was taken down because it was an infringement of community guidelines. She was talking about torture. I mean, this was a public political debate. Complete free speech. Why? It turns out that most likely there were political opponents in that country that started downloading her video and got it ejected from YouTube because they claimed it was a violation of guidelines. And YouTube fell for it. Even though it seemed to have a human review in there, YouTube completely fell for it. Eventually YouTube put up the video again and talked with her, tried to smooth it out, but obviously she is in a position of relative power, so she was able to get some kind of correction. That shows really the power they can have in circumstances where it would be important that they don't do these things. The second aspect is, of course, passive speech. And of course, the Facebook newsfeed, where Facebook, when you join, you have agreed to delegate some of your intelligence, some of your own agency, to Facebook to decide what's good for you to hear. So they make all those decisions, but they're not accountable for how the decisions are. And of course, behind this use, we get the whole crisis in journalism, Sanctify, etc., etc. And a whole lot of issues that are really opaque to people. I mean, Cambridge Analytica is part of that. Really opaque, and we're not able to have a civil discourse around those issues because of the crisis. Another example that's actually closer to the US is data protection for health. So why is it closer to the US? Because the US has a few sectoral laws, and one of the areas where it has laws is health. You're allowed to ask for your health records from your health providers. And completely new business models emerge over that. So on the left is the startup, 23andMe, that does direct-to-consumer genetic testing for cheap. But they collect, they do genetic testing for their clients, but that's sponsored by venture capital, so that they can collect a lot of data that they can then repackage as data products for different companies, pharmaceutical companies and others. Right? But individuals can go there, and because of this law, essentially, they can download their genetic tests, their results, and they can go elsewhere. So they can just give it to the commons at OpenStack. Or they can give it to some project that emerges out of Colombia, actually, called DNAnet, where you can share your genome and you can improve your health by getting more cutting-edge feedback, or maybe even health science. So that's another aspect where data protection is quite important, is science. So the story of Google Food is very insightful there, where Google claimed, I don't remember exactly, around 2008, that they were able to predict the flu better than the CDC, the Center for Disease Control. And they built a system that predicted based on people searching symptoms, essentially on Google. And they were very successful with this system. They rolled it out, they partnered with the CDC, etc. And then they improved their service. They improved their service, their core search service, in the sense that they started auto-completing people's searches. They started modifying the service. Basically, the Google Flu was not maintained while the whole core Google services were evolving. So there was no calibration going on. Eventually, Google Flu essentially rotted as a service and started being inaccurate. Now we're in a situation where Google Flu is essentially useless for health prediction, for public health predictions, because it's not core to Google's service. The data is there and it's not used because they don't want to share it. Or actually, they share a subset, but it's not as powerful as they can. So again, I see this as a data protection issue because all my searchers, that's part of my data, it's an individual. And I cannot act on this data. I cannot decide to share it with scientists to improve health predictions. But Google has something. Google is in the position where it can decide for me, essentially. So of course, links workers' rights. So here, the favorite example is Uber, of course. Basically, we have to update the slides every week because a new scandal comes out. So this was the scandal from 2 days ago, where, of course, Google is taking a cut on every ride. That's their business model, at least that's what everyone expects. But it's also cheating, apparently, in presenting a different view of the transaction to each side. So it's telling the driver, the transaction cost for the rider was this much, but it's not true. The rider paid a different amount. So it's a complete, I mean, in a way, it's to be expected because they're in a position where they can do it. And there's no transparency there. But potentially, that means that drivers or users who have been scammed for years now could go back, ask their data, and ask for reparations. Right? They have a mechanism where they could. In Europe, where they could counter this position. This is the scandal from yesterday. The scandal from 2 days ago, and this is the scandal from yesterday. Where actually, Uber deliberately seems to have spied on Lyft drivers that were driving both for Uber and Lyft, trying to find out the drivers that they should attract, both to help their service and hamper Lyft's service. Right? So they were deliberately spying, pretending to be a user on the Lyft service, to see where the cars were around their fake users so that they could see, oh, we have a Uber driver in the same position, so that's really the same person. So let's try to figure out how to get them with us. So again, that's a complete violation of data protection rights from a European perspective. From a European drivers, you can't do it. You can't sell someone as part of your business. Okay, so I'm going with a civil society perspective, and now Jerome will talk about the other thing.
Hi, thank you for being here. Surveillance capitalism is a concept that I think was brought first by Christian Hansel of Paul-Olivier mentioned. I would recommend to read their work, it's really enlightening. This is how I very humbly try to summarize what she's done. She talks essentially about the lack of reciprocity between consumers and the new giant capitalist Facebook, Google, or the data-driven societies. And I think it can be summarized in this simple fact: users don't pay anything, so you don't owe them anything. The only entities that owe something to Facebook are the customers. Facebook needs to deliver customer service to companies that pay advertising to them, but they actually don't have to do anything to the users because they don't pay anything. In business, what you say is that if you not paying, you are the product. And this is what's happening here. However, there is one thing. I think as a user, we pay to Facebook, we pay with our privacy. And that's how I try to summarize it here. And it's very important, I think, going forward, that as users of all those free platforms, we realize that every time we use those platforms, we tend to feed an economic system that is then completely disconnected from us. Another issue that comes with that is that we have no feedback on the value of the data we provide to users. Therefore, without feedback, we keep on giving away data, and data we put photos, we chat on WhatsApp, and so on. And we do it for free because we don't know the value of it. And when there is no value, we actually don't feel we lose something. It starts all with terms and conditions that nobody understands anymore. Then, because you sign those terms and conditions, they take it for granted, they have the right to with the data you give to them, they then transfer this data into assets and then into corporates that act essentially as fund manager for data, and they try to spin off innovations based on data and so on and so on. That's how we can summarize the so-called Facebook economy or Google economy. The big problem is that those corporations become super huge. And it's very tough to come with alternative models because Facebook is free. I think you had mentioned that a few months back. There are alternatives to Facebook, such as the diaspora, or other alternatives to many things we tend to use for free. But as soon as we have to pay, we tend not to use those things. So those services that are more ethical tend to die very fast or never really become big. And because there are also network effects, you want to be on the social networks where most of your friends are. You don't want to be isolated in another space just because they are more ethical. It comes with a huge trust to decide as a user not to use the common platforms. This is an example. There was a LAN network operating on the internet. They were proud not to show anything about their users. They ended up dying a few weeks back. They said because of the Facebook system, they could not survive anymore because all the advertisers were massively running to Facebook and Google systems, and their ads were not targeted enough. So that's an example. Another problem that comes again from us giving always data to those tech giants is that those tech giants, and that becomes then a business issue for many other companies, tech giants start increasing their scope of work and they start getting more margins out of existing players. If you look at the FMCG industry and the relationship between that industry and Amazon, it's very interesting because they start as an infrastructure, as a marketplace, but then Amazon also collects tons of data on the customers of those brands, and because they have so much intelligence, they start offering more and more and more and more services to those companies, and actually the act of intermediation becomes always bigger. And they do that, for example, with Alexa, which is a huge intelligence base for Amazon. And as I say, it becomes a business issue because then what we see is Amazon launching its own product in the face of their old customers, FMCG customers. So they launched diapers and so on. And they didn't do that, probably even better than the old FMCG because they had more intelligence on the customers than the FMCG industry itself. And this is, if we want to generalize a little, this is what happens a lot in the digital industry. You have a new player that comes that is data driven. They come as an infrastructure. So they unbundle that aspect of the business of one company. So for example, Amazon presents itself as a marketplace. But very fast with all the data, they start offering value-added services in other aspects of the key activities of a company. They start with customer relationship and end up doing the migration. So it's really a risk for the economy to see those tech giants expanding in all kinds of dimensions. They're not just providing advertising, they're not just offering a marketplace, they start doing more and more and more. And I think for an economy, if we want to have free market type of policies, it's very dangerous because we really enter in an antitrust issue, I think, in the long run, if we don't think about data ownership differently. Because it starts really with us giving data for free. Going further into that, of course, data is the raw material for most innovation. And if you read a little bit the newspaper, the next industrial revolution, and so the next wave of wealth creation in the planet will be based on the AI innovations. If all the data is in the hands of five or six players, it means all the wealth that is created out of that data will be in the same hands. That means the fourth industrial revolution will not have the same positive effects on the society and on the global economy than previous revolutions used to have. I think that's a big danger. And talking about the need for data in AI-based innovation, the very small AI, not the light one that we tend to see now, but the next ones, the ones that are coming, really need a huge quantity of data. That's why you see this kind of curve. That's something, for example, in the self-driving cars industry, you really need, it's only very recently that companies like Tesla or Uber found they had enough data to actually put cars on the street. And it took them many years because Tesla had cars on the road for many years and was capturing tons of data for so long. And it's only after this triggering point that they could launch cars, and that will be pretty much the same in every kind of innovation. So it's not enough for a company to say, well, we will change our policies and try to gather data and launch an app and say, let's be more data-driven, data-focused. I think it's just a pointless competition. The data giants have all the data, or pretty much all of it, and I don't think there is a way for non-data-driven companies to catch up. It's too late. So again, the ownership models of data becomes quite important if you think about it like that. As a result, because they have the data, they don't have a monopoly on what exists, but they have a monopoly on to decide what can exist and what should disappear. Recently, as for this, Facebook opening a new venture capital fund, an incubator in Paris, $400 million fund. This looks great, and yes, this is great in a way, but it shows how data-driven startups and the innovators really need to hook up with Facebook if they want to have a chance, because Facebook has all the data again, and so if you're a young startup willing to do any kind of things that needs data, you need to grow in that fund. So Facebook really decides then who can exist or who should not exist. If they find that you're relevant, you want get money, and your innovation won't come out. When I say they can choose who can disappear, they really do it. A lot of startups grow using Facebook data, and then suddenly Facebook gets access to the data. There are hundreds of examples of that in the newspaper, if you look carefully. This is an example of what happened. So there was an app doing something with videos, your upstream video from a mobile device camera is shut down because it can be done already through the Facebook app. And on the same day, Facebook announced that they are launching similar services on the platform because they were offering some features that Facebook didn't have. That's why the application had success, and Facebook said, oh, that's a great idea. Let's shut them down and we just do the same. So again, all wealth, all innovation in the hand of a few actors. I think this is a great danger. Another issue that comes against from us giving data for free is this issue of jobless growth, and I think here it's a bit ironic. If you look at the economy, it's a way to look at it is the output is a function of what labor produces and what capital is producing, and what labor can produce with capital. What's happening is with the 14th industrial revolution, we create AI that comes at a very, very cheap price compared to us, to our price as a worker or employees. And in the economy core, if you're a substitute to something, and that something is free or extremely cheap, you disappear. That's simple rules of market. So we have a whole lot of labor being transferred into the capital category of the economy, there's the subcategory of artificial intelligence, and there will be still some workers, the complementary ones, so the workers who can work with AI, the workers who enable AI to work at Uber, you're an engineer, you are this N++, very qualified worker who can, who is necessary for AI to work, then you will keep a job. But in fact, that AI, that qualified labor, what you find out is that by certain time it's paid stock option in shares, so it's in fact a cost of capital. We're really going in this direction of an economy that is totally valuable capital without labor. I mean, I'm not an economist, I think that we deserve a thesis, but many people, many experts say this is what's coming, or some kind of that will be coming soon. And again, this is ironic because AI is produced with our data. Which reminds me, a few years back, I was doing an internship in a company, and suddenly I was invited in a presentation, and there were a strategy consultant explaining to all employees, like I would be a consultant, and I said, you're all fired, because we're moving to India. They were moving the HQ to India. And the week after, I went back to the office and there were Indian workers sitting next to each of you. And you had to teach your job to each of those workers. I saw that. I thought, well, the workers, they are fired and they need to teach their job to the Indian workers who will take over the job. This is what we do, in fact, every day with our own data. Because we are teaching. Every time you upload a picture, you chat on WhatsApp, whatever you do with all those technologies, and every time you give data, you are feeding those future AI systems that will replace some jobs. So I think the analogy is quite interesting. Actually, that was already covered in an article. It was sort of workers in NAFTA, but they are robots. Maybe they shouldn't have loved them that much. Geopolitics. Same chart. In fact, the chart I was showing you before is a chart that was shown in the French Senate itself by this guy, Laurent Alexandre, an expert on the topic. And the issue we have in Europe is that we don't have those assets. We don't have our own Facebook, we don't have our own Google. So we will lose the worker, but we don't have the assets that replaces them, which doubles up the issue. At least in the US or Russia or China, you have your own huge tech giants. So losing the workforce and transferring that into wealth is one issue, probably, but at least you can decide on how to split that wealth with universal revenue or that kind of things. But in Europe, we are losing the workers. Global wealth is actually crossing the Atlantic. And that was a strong debate in the French Senate. They were talking about in terms like digital colonization. This guy was telling the French Senate that France would be the equivalent to Zimbabwe within the next 20 years if the French government would do nothing. So there's really this trend. I think data will be more and more a source of geopolitical tension and conflict of interests. Not only in Europe, you see that in Russia, of course, BT was recently blocked from Russian ground. Of course, they use always some kind of laws and explanations, but there is really a geostrategic interest behind all that, if you analyze and read between the lines. Same in China, Uber had to give up some kind of deal. So most big economic borrowers manage to give space to their own tech giants, which we have all done in Europe. Solutions. In Europe, we found a way. I mean, part of a solution. This is a new regulation that will be applicable as of May 2018 that will completely reshape the data environment. I won't go into details. If you want to, I mean, this is on the website first, but you can ask questions after. It creates new rights, it reinforces new rights. I think what is important to remember is the right of access, so the right for anyone to access a copy of the data that a data controller like Google has on it. A right to receive a copy that is reusable in another IT system, and right to portability. So that would be my right to tell Facebook, give all my data to diaspora. Which is interesting because it means data is not an exclusive asset. It means data becomes replicable. And as a user, I can create as many copies as I want and give it to whom I want. So it changed the economy. It's the start of a change of the ownership model of data, because data is not unique anymore. It can be at multiple places under the control and the consent of users, data subjects. That law also has wider territorial scope, so it means it's applicable to any EU citizen, so any person who is in Europe has those rights, wherever the company that is processing the data is. So that's quite interesting. It means it goes further than EU borders. And then EU is also trying to upscale the whole data protection environment across the world, because they go into negotiation as we speak with countries like Japan and many others to say, look, if you want to do to transfer data from Europe to a country, you need some kind of equivalence between your legal system and ours. Otherwise, you need to find a solution. It harmonized the whole regulation across the whole EU, because that's one of the problems we had. I think one of the key reasons why we don't have tech giants in Europe yet is because the laws were quite different in multiple places, and so it's very difficult for one single actor to see Europe as a single market in those sort of circumstances. It introduced class actions, right? So that's in the chapter of enforcement, and the fines are huge. In the past, the problem is that European citizens had rights, but the consequences of not complying were too low for companies. Now we talk about fines up to 4% of the annual turnover of the company worldwide. You know, so it's huge, and I think that's a great incentive to come back. As I mentioned, there is this right for portability. This is what we as a startup bet a lot on in terms of solving the issues. Because if we push it really to the maximum, and you think of a portability that is there all the time, now you have the right to move your data, get a copy only a few times a year, which limits the application of it. But in the long run, if you manage to have a full-time portability of data, I think we could think of an ecosystem on the internet where users are totally in control of the data they own, and they decide totally who gets it and who doesn't get it. So users could also receive value from your data instead of giving away all the value to the data processors, as it is the case currently. It means you could decide, for example, to give your genetic information to a cancer researcher for free, if you like, or you could give your data to an airline against some mileage, loyalty cards, points. That's an ecosystem that is able now to arise with this new regulation in the EU, but we need to push the regulations a bit further. So that's a regulation. It's a nightmare for existing companies, because it means I mean, they need a lot of retrofitting from an IT perspective, because if you think of an insurance company, for example, you have data that you collected when you get a new customer, but then you have data with the financial systems. When you bill a customer, you get other kind of data when the person gets sick, and then claims reimbursement, and all that tend to navigate in different IT systems. Now, as in Europe, as a customer of an insurance company, I can reclaim all that data, and I have to send it in, I think, 60 days or something. That's a nightmare technique. It looks simple, but for companies that don't like Facebook or Google, it's very tough. So compliance will come with a cost. So we need technologies. We really need new technologies, like the one we try to create to allow companies to be compliant without being unprofitable. And of course, we need new business models around data. This is also what we try to do. Innovation, to summarize, that we need is in compliance, so that companies be compliant. But we also need a better interfacing with customers. The issue now, if you have an issue, if you have a problem on Facebook, it's very tough to find an email, a phone, or a person to talk to explain I had an issue while using Facebook and so on. It's even very difficult to find a place where you can ask for data if you want to. Let's imagine in Europe. So we need new systems to enable communication on a permanent basis between those companies and each and every user, which is challenging when you think about the numbers. As we talk about billions of users of one company, and there's a lot of things going on. And of course, we need innovation to manage consent of people. The problem is that Europe, and that's great that they say that, but Europe says you need to ask consent to users in a contextual way. So they say terms and conditions are invalid. We don't take that for consent. Means, for example, if you want to send an ad to a person on the website, you need to ask him his consent before. But imagine the number of consent requests that would need for each and every user is very tough. It would become actually very nightmarish for users themselves, because it would be like, okay, stop asking me my consent all the time. So we also need technologies to anticipate consents of users while still giving some form of control to the user. It's not in control, it's not a consent anymore, which is a bit of a paradox. But we need, and there are innovations in this field. Startups now are trying to develop AI systems which would anticipate the consent of users in some respect, depending on the history of consent they have given. That's it.
In the American election. And that brought to awareness, the idea that the internet is now a site of conflict between nations. And of course, it has been for a long time, but people have tended to think of this in relation to the Internet of Things. The Stuxnet attack, for instance, was very widely publicized. Do people know about Stuxnet? Some of you do. It was malware designed by the Americans and the Israelis to essentially blow up the Iranian nuclear reactors, but actually it sort of escaped its bounds and did a lot of damage all over the world and was very widely publicized. And that drew the attention to the fact that it was produced by US Cyber Command, which was created by Obama to bridge the military and intelligence services and cyber operations, both offensive and defensive cyber operations. And it was news to a lot of people that the US might be engaged in offensive cyber operations. But nevertheless, it didn't really affect the public perception very much. Because I think Obama very skillfully managed the public perception of America and its role in the internet. So he committed himself publicly to the idea that the internet is a commons and not a domain of conflict. And he did so specifically after the Snowden revelations in 2014. He issued a presidential policy directive, number 28, in which he stressed the importance of affirming, quote, our commitment to an open, interoperable, and secure global internet, and the legitimate privacy and civil liberties concerns of US citizens and citizens of other nations. He also characterized Russia and China, by contrast, as being interested in informational sovereignty. So America was to be seen as safeguarding a global commons, whereas these other state actors were only interested in strategic interests in conflict. Of course, Obama could do this from a de facto position of American dominance, because no other state has yet replicated the power of Silicon Valley with the enormous companies like Google, Facebook, Microsoft. Although China is actively trying to create an all-encompassing system of surveillance that has been reported on recently. So this presidential policy directive had both strategic and economic importance for the US. It's very important in America that it's seen to be embracing those values, because trust is essential to the economy in this realm. The experience with the Russian hacking demonstrates that with the global internet, we just can't live with a situation in which anything goes, and trust can very easily be undermined. So PPD28, as I refer to it, has been very important for establishing international trust in US technology, and it's a problem if that trust is put in jeopardy. One thing that it's very important for is protecting the Privacy Shield Agreement. The Privacy Shield Agreement enables transfers of personal data from the EU to the United States. EU restrictions on transferring data outside the EU are a very important trade issue, because the EU is the US's largest trading relationship. And in fact, annual transatlantic trade in digital services amounts to $260 billion. And of course, information transfers support almost all other trade flows. So the Privacy Shield Agreement is essential, but it's something that has often been in jeopardy because, for instance, of the idea that the data transferred might be subject to surveillance by the US, for instance, NSA surveillance. So it's very easy to undermine the trust that keeps this economy going. So I think an important question is whether or not that kind of trust is in jeopardy under this administration. A lot of people that I've read who are experts in this field seem to think that Obama handled this very skillfully right up until the end with the Russian attacks during the election, and that those were fairly disastrous from the point of view of establishing trust in this international commons. There have for a long time been simmering conflict over various related issues. So the Putin regime in particular were very upset for a long time about the central role the US played in setting the rules of the internet through what's called the Internet Corporation for Assigned Names and Numbers, or ICANN. And they wanted to assert more control over the internet within their own borders. That especially became an issue after the Snowden revelations. That really convinced particularly a lot of Russians that it was very important that they have more control. So what ICANN does is safeguards the domain name system. So in other words, the system for looking at web addresses, so when you type in a web address, thanks to the DNS system, you can just have an easily memorable name rather than a set of numbers. And ICANN, based in America for a long time, has been responsible for that. So the US government essentially had oversight. Now what Obama did, which was very important and also in a way inevitable, was transfer that US government oversight to a multi-stakeholder nonprofit, which now takes on board the views of companies, experts, academics, and nation states in how the web ought to be run. During that process, which as I say was very important to Obama maintaining the view of the internet as a commons and not as a conflict, various Republicans were openly belligerent, including Ted Cruz and Donald Trump. So they thought that doing this, giving up US government oversight, it would be effectively handing over control to countries like China and Russia. And they use quite belligerent language in speaking about this, so that attitude to it was openly combative. And of course, now that Donald Trump is the president, that's going to raise concerns about how he wants to approach this whole set of issues. He's also already caused a great deal of alarm about the Privacy Shield Agreement when he signed his executive order about immigration. He wanted to deny privacy to non-US citizens. And that raised a lot of concerns in the EU. So far, the Privacy Shield Agreement has survived. But the indications that this administration has given so far is that they're not going to have the same set of interests as Obama did in maintaining international stability and maintaining the idea of the commons at the core of that. If you do sustain that, then we can work out a set of international norms rather than descend into open conflict. Conflict is going to be bad for everybody, because rather than one one state having essentially a great deal of control over the internet, it will mean that everybody is surrendering a lot of control. So a situation of open cyber warfare is one that everybody needs to avoid. So I think we need to keep a very close eye on what is going on in terms of policy in order to safeguard that. And all of the initiatives that might protect individuals are going to rely on very broad decisions made by governments about what the future of the internet is going to look like.
There's actually a movie on the passing of the law itself. Because the, and a lot of the movies about the intense lobbying efforts of Uber, Facebook, and so on against that movie. And democracy, it's in German. It's the, translate literally, it's in the smoke of data. So you see some meetings of the lobbies of Facebook explaining why it would be so bad for citizens to. It's quite funny and interesting movie. And now we are in the second phase of interpretation of the law. So because the law is dictated in a few points and there is a working body that has to bring accuracy and explaining how it seems or so on. And of course, there is another way of lobbying happening to explain what product we actually means, how we want to implement it technically, what we're forced to do it or not, if technology is not a role in that happens. And again, portability is not yet the portability we dream about, which means Facebook has to be all the data in real time. But it's quite limited because of the process that is set up. You cannot do it permanently all the time. So it means, for example, if I want to create as a startup a service based on geolocation, and I think using the geolocation that data that Uber is collecting on its user would be relevant for me for any kind of reason. I cannot actually do it because if you do a service for geolocation, you need the data to come at the time, otherwise, it makes no sense. So it's not yet what it would be wrong. But this is a huge step away. And there was a lot of things from trading, for example, you want to move your data from one insurance company to another, it's probably important that you can move this from. So you get both parts as well. The car industry is also part of it. Tesla has its own insurance because they have the data. And so they can better than any other insurance company estimate the risk. And so that transfers into a competitive advantage because people can then offer the price for the cost because it's not even insurance that is cheaper than if you look for the car insurance. But if user can take the Tesla data and give it to another insurance, competitive advantage is not safe. That's really the case.
This raises a large question, it seems to me, about the questions of scope and scale, the large economic questions here about the data. Because I can imagine that in some contexts we'll have interest in moving some of our personal data, perhaps. These seem, you know, more confined contexts, like, for instance, you know, we want our photos or our pictures or our emails or something like that moved maybe from one serving company to another. You get our Facebook or TikTok or something like that on some limited amounts of our personal data. But when you think about the whole enormous picture of the economic implications of this, which you were discussing in terms of kind of the creation of capital and AI and the loss of labor, it seems as if the fundamental problem is that so much of our data is relatively worthless or worth so little to each individual one of us, right? And one would think that, I mean, you know, sometimes you hear numbers like $10 a year or something like that is what one individual person would be worth. But in contrast, of course, this is the primary resource, which in the aggregate can be worth so much, right? So if you've got 1.3 billion users, all of a sudden $10 really accumulates, right? And so, but it seems that that's the fundamental tension or problem here, which obviously creates the collective action problems, or maybe we can think about it in different ways, but it seems that that's the major problem, is that we just, so many of us are not going to have the interest in, you know, picking up the penny off the floor when you get some pennies on the floor, except when you get some pennies on the floor, if you look around. But, you know, each and every one of us doesn't have that interest, and yet this is such a transformative, kind of revolutionary economic moment in the aggregate, right? And it's at this juncture that seems as if it almost makes it feel as if we're on some, you know, we're just inevitably going down this path without any real way to resist. And, yeah, I don't know. So that seems to be, yeah, go ahead.
I think one feature of that is that you just use the word data, and a lot of people don't think you need to be a techie or quant to understand all the issues. So I think finding a language that ordinary people can understand in order to describe the problems is going to be a really important aspect of having a movement to support these kind of visions.
So a big question on control, of course, but there are many solutions for this, the problem you described. So and trust, using trust, legal trust, to put in charge of handling your data. Handling your consent, which the consent is itself a level of you. So you could delegate this to some entity of trust, so that you don't have to do it yourself. You could also own the data through cooperatives. You know, workers, AI worker cooperatives. There's all kinds of models that are possible once individuals are in control. And we have some market where people are free to innovate in terms of ownership models, governance models, and those things. And actually, a lot of the startups that are innovating in that space, a lot of them have chosen an ownership model, governance models, etc. We personally think that this is good, but it's not the end, because there's not going to be one. If you think about it, your energy consumption data. So you're probably going to attract lots of different models.
So one small other than before we open it, what's the ancillary issue there then also has to do with questions of trust somehow. It seems to be trust here at UST. In the sense of those individuals, it seems, who are concerned about the privacy of their data, there's got to be a high correlation between persons who are concerned about the privacy issues, right, and distrustful of another entity somehow getting a hold of your data. And so, I mean, it's every time I see an innovation, such as, for instance, the recent one I saw was one where, you know, it's an innovation which will generate randomized searches, Google searches for you constantly, right? And the idea here is that by generating these completely randomized Google searches, you're creating so much noise that and of course, that sounds like a fascinating idea and really interesting in terms of resistance and disobedience. Because my first thought is, right, but I mean, you know, why would I trust this entity to be claiming to be doing these Google searches on my behalf when in fact that could just what I could be doing without even knowing it is here, just giving them all of my information, right? Which I probably am. Somehow embedded into the system in such a way as to be generating other searches. But so there's also this question of, you talk about a trust or some other fiduciary relationship, but of course those do require trust. And we're operating in a world in which those who are thinking about these issues are inherently worried.
When economy actor exists for a long time, loneliness is the banking industry. Banks do not have such a great reputation anymore because people get money and essentially put this value into them. They still actually trust them to practice. And what banks do with money is in fact something they could do with data. If your data is an asset that has a certain value and you need to put it out there in the market to make it more profitable for you, also guarantee the security and the privacy of your financial assets and so on, I think banks could be a major player. So if we go in this economy or trust, data trust, they could play a role.
To complement the question I was asked earlier, some of the players, the new players in this area, are the big telcos. So in Europe,
automatically think of at least what I think of is NSA surveillance, right? Or years and years of cooperation, illicit and licit, which, you know,
right? So, our question.
So in the past, we went into a store and we purchased some groceries, and the merchant had a transaction. Today, you buy the same thing on Amazon, and the merchant has the same transaction. So how do we lead to the conclusion that information regarding, let's say, your purchases online versus in-store are private to you? So that's the first question. The second observation is, in the European context, if you look at certain countries, France, for example, they collect an enormous amount of data, which is continually consistent. It's almost an obsession in France in terms of the amount of information that they collect on their citizens. So if you're talking about a portable data, if you went to the French government and said, give me all my data, what would happen? I can guarantee you nothing. It wouldn't give it to you. The third observation is, if you went to, you had this example there, the principal company that said, we're not going to share your data with them. So if you went to Facebook and you said, okay, rather than legislating, you need to give everyone the opportunity upon notice to give them their data. If you worded it in such a way, it said, okay, you have that option, I'll give you that option. But if you exercise that option, it's an imposter. In other words, you can't use Facebook for free anymore. Because, I mean, there is value to your website. To your point, that will establish a cost. People will then see the relevance of that. But this proposal that I'm hearing here has got to be the most misguided thing I've ever heard in my life. If you want to develop a digital industry here, this is not the way.
Let's take two more questions. So the first question is to make sure what is the difference between the data of Amazon, for example, and volunteers?
Well, I mean, I think there is a clear distinction in people's minds of what constitutes personal data. The date of birth, your records. I mean, but even that, candidly, if you look at, zip code information, you get access to zip code information. Geospatially, you can get right down into a neighborhood and identify kind of what people earn in a particular building. And it's the same thing in France or in Germany. Again, that information exists in the public domain. It is not proprietary. Okay? The information that Facebook is collecting, for example, is information on your browsing history or various other things. And yes, I mean, you could say that's intrusive, okay? But then you could also say, if the internet is a public domain, then what's in the public domain isn't private, okay? If you want a private communication channel, okay, then sign up for a private communication channel, and they exist, by the way, okay? There are servers out there that allow you to communicate via email in a way that cannot be monitored. Sign up for that service is what I'm saying. It's going to cost you, okay? So it's a question of, if you don't want to communicate in public, you want to communicate in private, then communicate in private. But don't confuse the two. So again, I don't know how the internet is going to be a public channel for communication if you're going to put all these restrictions on.
You didn't write the book.
No, I'm not saying you did, but you're putting it up here as a juxtaposition in a way of everything that's wrong with, let's say, the U.S. approach. And candidly, I can see a lot of issues with the U.S. approach. But that approach, I can guarantee, is absolutely wrong.
It's probably one of the ways where it's wrong. Your arguments conflating privacy and data protection when you buy something on Amazon is something I try to preempt in the presentation. It's not a question of privacy, it's a question of data protection. when you buy something on Amazon, it's not a question of this being private. It's a question of control you have over the data that Amazon is collecting. And that's where you construct. What does that mean for control? The control on what Amazon can do with that data and what you. That's really the issue. It's not a question of privacy.
But again, I appreciate that, but we're confusing sort of the medium, is what I'm saying. Assume there's no internet. Okay? Assume the only place you can buy things is the corner store at Macy's. Okay? Macy's collects all that information, is what I'm saying. Okay? And they use it for various purposes, for business intelligence, for purchasing decisions, for conveying to their suppliers trends and various other things. It's how commerce works. And by the way, the whole basis of capitalism, okay, is based on information asymmetry. That's how we work. That's how profits and risks are shared throughout the system. There have always been information asymmetries, and they will always exist. If we had perfect information, we'd have perfect markets, we'd have no opportunity for profit.
Let's take an extreme case. Let's take a case where you're not buying something on Amazon, you're buying something extremely sensitive that many you share. Right? So you go and you buy the pharmacy medication, and the pharmacy will potentially sell that information about you or package it in a way that would be anonymous, and that would be they can allow to draw inference about your healthcare provider, your doctor, etc. I know there's a Supreme Court case so on exactly that issue that deems that the purchase information in the pharmacy is not protected. It's less protection than the data collecting information of someone. I'm not a legal expert, but from my viewpoint, and I think for many Europeans, that's wrong.
Well, actually,
so then we move on to another person.
It's a one-level one point. Let me yes. But he said it, anonymized. Point is, if selling your personal information regarding prescription drug purchases is illegal. Even in the United States, if I'm saying, you cannot share that information. Okay? However, if it's anonymized and people can basically use it for purposes of deciding kind of trends and various other things, that's absolutely okay, is what I'm saying. Why wouldn't you?
The reality of the ecosystem right now is that there are lots of players who are de-anonymizing this data.
Yes, they are. As they should be.
So as the light moves, some important points here, though, this goes to the notion that property rights are entirely constructed. Right? We construct, we define what are property rights. And so I think that that's an important part of the discussion because there's a certain way in which some of the technology is creating relations that subsequently then kind of define property, possession of particular kinds of information, which changes, I think, some of the relations. So, if you used to go to a store, you paid cash, it was an anonymous transaction, right? And a lot of economic transaction was in that way anonymous. There wasn't that information gathering technology that comes into play as a result of either the use of credit cards or the use of digital technologies. And so it's probably really important to divorce the question of technology from the question of property rights, so that we can then design them in the way in which it makes the most sense. One of the problems right now, I think, is that it's the technology that's driving possession questions, possession of information, and as they say, possession is an against the law, but it's that possession that then defines the scope of property rights, and so somehow it has to be a case that we're really delinking those and then rethinking property interests and personal.
Just to add one fact that's very important to your question that we didn't say we should, is that this portability only applies to the data that has been directly given by the individual. content in an explicit way or has been collected in some time, not on the profits.
Yeah, don't worry too much about portability around Linux and everything. Metadata standards and formats make it extremely difficult to engineer your systems to transmit. But that aside, a lot of people use the metaphor of the press available for everybody, so that you can post these things online. Now everybody has access to it. Like in the 90s, we used to have to do the HTML by hand if we wanted to publish something on the internet. Nowadays, these companies like Facebook and Google, et cetera, Twitter, make it possible for everybody to have access to a press. Now, we're academics. We have been dealing with presses long before. Do systems that filter what gets in there? For a reason, maybe it was a completely bad idea to allow a press to everybody. Now, this distinction between privacy and publicity here defined as when we do an act of publishing actively, seems to be part of the conversation yet not mentioned in the distinctions that you made. When we talk about data protection, we have to remind ourselves that large monopolies like the finance own most of the knowledge produced by academics in the planet today, tied to Goldman Sachs. It's, for example, all of the dissertations produced in the United States, because they own a minority interest in the Cambridge Information Group, which owns Provost. Now, I don't see us even taking control for protecting our own data, which is tied to our names. how do you link our possibilities, our hope, to our fight now to even liberate and protect our own materials?
So I was thinking maybe before, maybe we can do it now, and I'm very sympathetic to all the fights around open access and all those things. But I think academics will just see the world change around them, and sometimes the problem will be solved.
Oh,
we solved one side of academia, that's my opinion. I mean, the problem is people expanding, and there's a little pressure that individuals feel in academia, the pressures around them, collaboration and so on. Anytime you spend on advocating for open access and all those things, it's time lost. It's some cost for you.
I would say something about this. A few years ago, 5 years ago, there was a major development in connection with open access that a mathematician, wrote on his blog, Tim Gowers, a statement objecting to practices of Elsevier and saying that he was no longer going to work with Elsevier, no longer going to referee for. And somebody turned this into a petition, and it got in very short order. It gathered more than 10,000 signatures. It started among mathematicians and then physicists and branching out. And then came the question, what happens next? So for mathematicians, ultimately, what happened was that Tim Gowers, together with Cambridge University Press, started a new model, which I won't go into. It's been tested. The results are not yet in. But in the interim, there was a discussion about how you can maintain the services that are provided by the publishers. And the consensus was that there's one service that the publishers provide, the actual publishers provide, and that is. It's the signal, it's identifying which journals are better than others.
Oh my God.
And that's because if there's no editorial board, and the editorial board is the journal's editorial board, if there's no editorial board to guarantee the quality, then anybody can publish. Well, there is, of course, a platform for anybody to publish, which is the archive. People do that. In fact, people hardly even, in mathematics, hardly even look at published papers anymore, because they've already seen them in print form. After they've been validated as very important for career decision, promotions and so on, but the actual information is communicated for them. So one of the proposals and this came from several different sources, one of the proposals for democratizing the decision making was to introduce something like Amazon ratings. So people, the readers would then give a certain number of stars to papers, and the ones that got the most stars would be deemed most important. But of course, the rating that there's room for abuse, so the raters will themselves have to be rated. I think the lesson it has not been introduced to that whole thing. It has, but although there are people, some people did feel this was from the democratization, the lesson is that the interaction of social media has infiltrated the way people think about academia. I don't think it's necessarily for the best, but that's a different discussion.
But Michael, wouldn't the age index function in a somewhat more traditionally academic way than a kind of Amazon star system? Right? I mean,
so my understanding is that all of this impact factor is a no use in mathematics. And since it started in mathematics, that would not have been a good option because it just doesn't, it is not going to happen to fully adapted to mathematics.
But wouldn't cite some notion of citation? I mean, wouldn't a paper that other people have relied on subsequent data be some form of indexing?
My understanding is that citation, the concept of citation as a measure of quality started here at Columbia with the Cole brothers about 50 years ago. And it was a way to make sociology of science quantitative. It was not intended as a metric of scientific value or productivity. And for the most part, again, I can say that certainly among mathematicians, the attempt to impose even reporting on citation indices, much less the use of citation indices, has been has been consistently resisted.
Last question. It's about enforcement. I think it's very bad. We have the health information thing here. It's supposed to be $100 penalty. Can't get it to happen. You can't get the team to go along with the threat of it. But the city has said committees that have put $10,000 a day penalties against people and they just ignore it. Just mitigate the labor, ignore it, and the problem go away. And then the other thing you said about picking up pennies. It costs money to pick up a penny. Just to be alive costs 3 to 10 cents per minute. So you calculate, it takes you 20 cents to pick up that penny. But that brings around the thing. It's so much work to do this stuff, to read these, and you need a license to read these. Thing, take this word. Anywhere, you know where I'm going with this?
Any other questions? So I don't know how much in the US
will be. Well, they have to do something everywhere.
So, but in Europe, it has been rocking for a long time, for sure. It helps now that there's some, it's a regulation, so it's homogeneous at the European level, the law, that's the case. And then there's, they've just streamlined the enforcement mechanism. So, it would be harder to form shop, for instance, in Ireland, because there wasn't a reader there or not enforced as well. So, we'll see what happens. But there seems to be real willingness to complete this work. And this is based on the regulation, the two layers of lobbying that Jerome is describing, where I'm doing a ton of freedom of information requests to see actually what the difference is between the two layers. And I can see that all the lobby efforts are just not very successful so far. So it seems quite, there's willingness.
Hi.
So I wanted to think about three points in relation to the question about why there's a difference between the brick and mortar transaction and the online transaction. I think one is that there's a difference between privacy and security. It's not even necessarily that we're worried about our individual level privacy. We're worried about how we are collectively being understood and how that is being used to modulate our actions and shape our psychological perspective. Not very different from advertising, but different in that we are less aware of it and that it's more pervasive because it's more subconscious. There are issues in relation to the fact that this is our intellectual property. We, our lives, our like actions, it belongs to us. A contract requires us to have some sort of notice because we have to be able to mutually assent to having that contract. So if we're not aware of it, then there's a problem. And then the final thing is if you buy something in a brick and mortar store, you might assume that the corporation is like is recording what you purchased and when you purchased it, but what if they followed you around the store and looked at what you were wearing, how much time you spent purchasing things, and what you looked like, and all these various other things about you that we would not feel comfortable with, which then is profitable as well.
Thank you very much for this great talk. I'm a data protection attorney in Paris. I worked a lot on data protection reform, and I think there is one big assumption here that this regulation is about prohibition. It's not at all about prohibiting data processing, not at all. The goal is to foster innovation. What we want is to have a frame, is to let people decide what we're going to do with this data. So, if you think about it, and I think that's the point you wanted to make, is if we have transparency, we can do the same processing of data, but just let the person know what is really going to happen. That's my first point. The point is transparency. The second point is to raise awareness, because if we want reinforcement, we have to have people to know what their rights are. And this is the main problem, because the right of access already exists today, but no one is using this right. Almost no one. In most of my clients' cases, they have three right of access complaint per year. So it's nothing. So that's one of the main problems. And if you don't have enforcement, you will never have efficient rights. And my third point is the concentration of data on the market, which is not a privacy or data protection issue, it's an antitrust issue. And this is a real problem, and we haven't done anything with the GDPR in order to tackle this problem.
Just one thing, so the right of access, because it's already quite important and relevant, it's actually relevant to everyone in this room. Yesterday I was talking about Cambridge Analytica, which has collected claims to collect the data of 200 million applicants, 5,000 data points, and happens to be located in the UK. So that means that potentially everyone here and pounds can ask for a copy of their data from Cambridge Analytica. It also means that every American who lives in France can potentially ask the French Data Protection Authority, which only got 3 requests of claims to write last year, can ask that authority to help them defend their rights in terms of access to data. So again, every American here can go and ask Cambridge Analytica to help their data. Every American living in Europe can do the same and has many more recourse mechanisms.
It's just the raise awareness part
that I wanted to talk about. And this can help in terms of raising awareness transactions.
I had actually maybe a slightly more technical question, but I was wondering how a piece of data is, what's the definition of a piece of data in that law and what you can request, and do companies that collect data have to keep it forever to be able to give it back, or
can they just use it and discard it and never have to give that back at any time? Because if I was Google, what I would want to do is just like take your data, update my model of you, and then throw it away and never have to give it back. And I've seen a lot of like recent reputations in that kind of direction. And just as a side thing, it's kind of the same thought I have all the time with like testing the robots. Like, how do you define the robots so that it gets types like, what if my entire factory is actually, like, let's say it's one robot? Or like,
a second. Or the first one is a point of data. There's no real definition of data. It's more personal data and it's information. So you have to look at the set actually of data points. And once you have enough data points, you are identifiable. And that set becomes personal data. So just think about individual letters in your brain. Each individual letter is not personal data, but the aggregate is. Right? Because you can aggregate your identifiable. That's the most, the best way to do it. And in terms of this circumvention is along by adding the time to a profile itself. Sure, you can do that. The profile can still be accessible under the web access, but not under the direction of data portability. I suspect that what most companies will do is what already Facebook and Google are doing to shield themselves from some form of portability is to just sync all the data into some log files that they claim is impossible to access. And extract the information they need, and when they build a new business model, they actually go through the effort of extracting the information.
So it was even more in relation with your like AI based workers and the AI is basically not my profile, it's like a model of profiles of millions of people, So if my contribution to that model is just like very small, and then they discard the actual data. Does it still fall under that group, and you can share it to another AI company? Or?
I think you're talking about the 22nd century. No.
Good. All right. I wanted to close the session. I wanted to thank Emily Group for all her work on the two sessions and. I wanted to suggest that you can sign up, and so the data will only be used for sending you emails telling you about other CCCCT events, and we will not be selling or sharing the data, although we will be sending you emails about other events. There's sign-up sheets outside. And I want to thank our audience, and I want to thank our speakers for asking.